were doing 19, 30, 50, and the car behind me's gone. And that just, it just puts a smile on my face every time I drive an electric car.
Hello, how we doing? You're back with Carl, and I have got another BMW review for you, and I've written down what it is, or the spec of it, because I'm not 100% sure. They were meant to send it to me, but they haven't. So I'm in a BMW i4 e-drive 40 M Sport. This is the M Sport, so it's got all the M Sport kit on it, and like, you know, the different seat belts, different seats, probably different wheels and brakes as well. If you're looking to buy one, then I'm pretty sure you're going to be looking at all the specs inside and out and looking at all the numbers and figures. I've tried to give you the basic ones so you've got an idea and so I don't sound like a complete idiot. My car's gone in for a couple of days, so they've given me this for a couple of days. I am just on my way back to collect mine and give this one back. But I didn't want to sound like a complete idiot and not have some specs for you. So it starts at £53,500. It is 250 horsepower. It's got 430 torque. It's 2.6 ton, 0 to 60 in 5.7, and a top speed of 118 mile an hour. The boot size is, I haven't got a clue. You'll see in the video, it's pretty big for a saloon. And this is impossible to compare against mine, because obviously mine's a small SUV, so you know, the iX3. I reviewed the iX a few weeks ago, and now the BMW Hailshum have given me this i4 to review, because apparently some people like my reviews, and they've had some people going into store and saying they've watched a review on the car that I've done, and they want to come and do a test drive. So very quickly, it is a lovely car. There's nothing not to like. BMW have done a great job in making it a BMW. So it works well, it drives well, it does everything you want it to do. One of the best things I like about BMW, and I'm not just saying that because I've had Audis, I've had Mercedes and so on, is it's a little, for me, it's a bit like an iPhone in respects to when you pick up a Samsung, they're brilliant phones, but they're quite hard to navigate. And for me personally, when I pick up an iPhone, they just tend to work. You press a button and you know where you're going. So with the onboard system in this one, it's a bit different to my wife's in hers, and it's a bit different to my one. But it's a bit different, but it works exactly the same. You just know where you're going. So I know you can't see what I'm doing, but climate control, press menu, and it all comes up. If you want to go back, you press back. You go to sound, you go to bits and pieces. And it's just really easy to navigate and get around, which I really, really like. And again, swapping from my Audi to my Merc to the BMW and a few other cars in between, I just find I always come back to this one. The BMW system, they just tend to work. All right, there's enough of me rattling on. Let's turn it on and see what it goes. So 0 to 60 is 5.7 pound talk. So coming out of a lay-by, put your foot down, 40, 60 plus, as always. So it is a far, it certainly feels quicker than my iX3. It should do, because I'm trying to shade on because I can't see where I'm going. The biggest thing for me in this, that was in eco mode, by the way, as well. That wasn't, I lie, I switched in sport. I'm completely lying to you. It was in sport mode. But if I'm honest, 95% of the time, this, the iX that I had, my iX3 that I drive every day, I pretty much just keep it in Eco Pro, because it does everything it needs to in Eco Pro. And when you put your foot down, it just punches and goes. It's, again, I've been saying this, I am a real petrol head, and I do love a twin turbo and a V8 and so on, but I generally and honestly don't miss the noise anymore. These are quiet, they're smooth. If I just go quiet and stop talking for a minute. They're just really, really peaceful, and maybe that's a sign of me getting old. I still like jumping in cars that make a lot of noise, but the instant torque and instant punch from an electric car, and I know I keep saying it, but it generally does still shock me. And the one question I get from all my friends and people that watch these videos quite a lot of the time personally is, do I miss having an engine and listening to the sound and changing gears? And I honestly don't. I've only had electric cars now 5 months, maybe 6 months, and I just don't miss the noise at all. I like it because it's quiet, I like it because it's smooth, I like it because it's instant torque, so the car in front of me is just pulling off. Again, we're doing 19, 30, 50, and the car behind me's gone. And that just, it just puts a smile on my face every time I drive an electric car. But the biggest thing for me between, I can't compare this to mine because it's a different car, so I'm going to compare it to my wife's 440. Obviously hers is a convertible, so it's a little bit different, it's a little bit stiffer, and hers is a petrol twin turbo. Speed wise this will keep up for everyday driving. It's actually quicker. It's only on the motorways that she'll disappear, and again, she's a good driver, I always say that, otherwise she'll kick my ass. But what I think, they've changed something. This turns in, so it's still a 4 series, the same as hers, but what I've noticed is this turns in quicker. So if you're going into, whether it be parking or you're going around corners or junctions, when you turn the steering wheel, you turn it a little bit and it just wants to turn much, much sharper. Again, it's a brand new car, so, you know, mind you, hers has only done 40,000 miles, so it's hardly worn in. So there's obviously, they've done a bit of tweaking with the chassis, and they've done a bit of tweaking with the steering and bits and pieces. But what I have noticed is how well it turns into corners. I'm on the back road from Battle back towards Hailshum. So if you know the road, you know it's quite fast in places. It's quite twisty and turny in places as well. And I've managed to test that a little bit, shall we say, on the way back. And again, it does everything you want it to do. Range-wise for the battery, I had a quick look online. I've only had it a couple of days, so I can't really test it. I believe it's 350 miles or thereabouts. That's what they've claimed. It could be a bit more, a little bit less. Again, if you're looking to buy one, then I'm sure you'll read up on the specs and work out if it's right for you. It's definitely more than mine and the iX3. So as it stands, I've got 103 miles left of range and 47% charge. But then I haven't been driving this economically for the last 2 days. So if you go on a long drive, that will expand quite a bit, I would imagine. Again, we're just sitting in traffic going nowhere. The other thing that I like in this car is the Harman Kardon sound system. It's still not, it doesn't blow you away, but I reckon for 90% of us, it will be absolutely fine. It's better than my one, even to the point I have emailed them today and said, can they double check that I'm not missing a sub? Because it is far better in this car than it is mine. So I don't know what's playing, just a little bit 90s classics on today. From, what's that? Very clear, very clear, crystal clear in at high volumes. There you go, a bit of meeting. The windows shake, the mirrors shake, so it's pretty bassy. Again, watching this on here, unless you're connected to a 5.1 surround sound system on your computer, that won't do it any justice whatsoever. But it is clear, it is loud, it is bassy. I personally would still like a little bit more bass, but it is definitely bassier than my iX3. I don't really know what else I can say. There's nothing to like. It's a great car, it drives well, it's torquey, it's fast, it brings a smile to your face, it's quiet. There's nothing in here that I'll go, oh, I don't like that, or I don't like that. The new dashboard that I'll show you in the video, it's nice and clean, it's a nice long screen. Again, I don't know if BMW have copied Mercedes or vice versa, or Audi, but they've all got the same now. The one in this is probably a bit smoother than the iX. The one in the iX is a lot bigger, but then it's a bigger car. The cabin is a little bit smaller, but then again, it is a different car to the iX, so you can't compare it. So if you've got any questions, please fire them away and I will do my absolute best to answer them. It's a very well made, reasonably priced 4 Series saloon. Again, it's going to be aimed at a certain type of market and a certain type of buyer. If I was to compare this to similar that I've had, I would say it would be on par with the C220 Mercedes that I've had and the Audi A4 S-Line. So that was a 190 diesel version, and the Mercedes was the 2 litre petrol, so one was a 2 litre petrol, one was a 2 litre diesel, but similar kind of weight size of car, and I would choose this every time. I have to be honest, there's nothing wrong with the other cars, and if you drive one of them, you would like them without a shadow of a doubt, because they're both nice cars. But for me, it always goes back to, at the moment anyway, the way these drive, the way they perform, the way they feel in your hands and under your feet and in the bends. I really do enjoy it. So there you go. Short and sweet, this one. It's a good car. I like it. It's fun. It's a good price, I believe. It ticks probably every box you need. There's no reason why you won't like it. If you have any questions or you want me to kind of think about something that I may not have thought about, by all means ask me in the comments and I will do my very best to reply. There you go. I'm going to shut up. I'm going to finish this drive and have a little fun, put some tunes on, and I'll see you on the next one. Hopefully I might be getting an Audi RS6, my dream car, but we'll see. So take care, see you soon. So a lot of people do ask about its overtaking potential, pretty much in any car, and people talk about 0 to 60, but I'm doing 45 plus, and everything has disappeared behind me. So when people talk about 0 to 60 and they rate cars at how fast they are, which is great, a lot of it is how fast it will pick up from when you want to overtake, whether it be an A road, a B road, a motorway, etc. It's when you're driving along and there's a gap or a space and you want to squeeze past, and how quickly does it punch and get past whatever you want. So again, we've got a lorry in front of me, we're clear, we'll go, and we're past it. Simple as that. So the ability to accelerate from like mid-speed, mid-power, forwards, is really important. And I just want to add that because this does it very, very well. So there you go. So let's have a quick little spin all the way around the car. Again, it's a standard kind of awesome BMW that it is. This is the, like I said earlier, the eDrive 40 i4. I do like these look pretty cool. Obviously, exhaust replacements of what would be on the M4, which is pretty nice. Little spoiler on the back. Again, from pretty much any angle, I think it looks pretty cool. I'd like slightly bigger wheels if it's me. Again, typical front end for an electric car. But although I do think this one, because it's not as big, not as glary as the i4 or the ix3, because it's a little bit smaller, the number plate's right in the middle, kind of hides it. Again, for me, I don't love the electric look at the front. Some people love them, some people hate them, but I think as far as electric car front ends go, this is actually pretty damn nice. Again, I know it's not a completely fair comparison, but the front end of the 22 full electric i4 versus the 440i convertible 2018. So what I want to do is compare the new 4 Series saloon versus my wife's 4 Series saloon. So if we have a look at them directly, now I know one's a saloon and one's a convertible, so it is a slightly different car, but again, they're modelled on the same vehicle. Chardet's is a 2018 model, but mainly kind of inside, I think the difference, again, 3-door versus a 4-door, so it's going to be slightly different. The interior is a little bit different, the seats are different. One thing I didn't really think about is, obviously in this, we've got the pre-selects, and again, that bit is slightly different in comparisons to this one. So it's got the much bigger screen, which is really great. The center console, of course, is a little bit different, but this one hasn't got the pre-selects. That's a bit upsetting. It's not the end of the world. But again, the interior is nice. This new screen is very, very nice. And then again, we look in the back, there's plenty of room. I'm not the tallest person in the world. It is a bit of a squeeze, but again, the camera doesn't do it much justice, does it? But once you're in, plenty of room, plenty of headspace for me. Again, I'm not the tallest person in the world. But there's plenty of room for me. I'm 5'7", so if that helps you. Again, the doors are really nice, interior's nice, everything's kind of stitched and kind of as BMW do in all their cars. So, you know, there's nothing not to like sitting in here. I'm not gonna lie, I've not even opened the boot on this. There you go, let's open the boot, see what we've got. So
Even for a Sloan, I would say that's a pretty big boot. So we've got some cubby holes, again, kind of standard stuff, what we've got under there. All the electrics and charging cables. Again, electric tailgate. Again, all cars come standard, really, don't they? So it's just kind of the comparisons in the 4 Series. Again, I know one's convertible, one's not. And the interiors.